What's going on, YouTube? This is Necrostevo, and it's finally time for the official Week 1 battle of the Indigo League of Legends Season 3. Now, if you haven't seen the team builder, you can find that in the same playlist as this video. Just wanted to go through and kind of look at some of the things that my rival Connor was bringing to Week 1. Now, as I saw the team preview for this battle, I actually really liked my matchup here. We do see Magmortar, Cloyster, Bastiodon, and Hitmonchan, as we thought. He unfortunately did bring the double win conditions of possibly Cloyster alongside Zygarde. But seeing Slurpuff there is pretty nice because Slurpuff can't really touch the team that I have. And Hitmonchan can't really spin as long as I keep Rotom on the field. So he could have spin on Cloyster as well. Don't have to worry about that either. Now I have to ensure that I stop Cloyster from setting up, and I also have to make sure that Zygarde is weakened to a point where that I can take it out with either Rotom with the Shadow Ball, who dodges Earthquake and a possible Extreme Speed, and at the same time, if I can catch either Magmortar or the Switch with Earthquake, looking at the team structure he had, I was actually a little bit worried about a Choice Scarf Magmortar. Based on this team that he has also, I didn't think that Slurpuff was the Belly Drum set. I figured that it would actually be playing a little bit more team support and be a more defensive set. And that turned out to be true as well. So I have my work cut out for me. Connor seems to have prepared for this battle a little bit more interestingly than I expected him to. Wow. I'm just going to blame being tired on that double on redundancy there. Anyways though, I'm going to go ahead and get into the match. I ended up bringing a kind of a cleric, a bulky cleric Togekiss instead of just going full offensive or fully defensive. So that happened. I will also say that it was a complete pain in the butt breeding Charizard for this battle. I wanted Hasty with max HP, attack, defense, I wanted a 6 IV Pokemon. I ended up getting all 5 IVs perfect except for defense, which was like a 29, which I'll take because defense get lowered by Hasty anyway. So I switched right out here in the beginning. I really didn't expect him to start off with something else. I switch out into my Togekiss, which is a more specially defensive one. He gets a critical hit on Flamethrower, and seeing that damage, I know that he's scarfed. If he were Specs or Life Orb, that would have done a lot more off of a critical hit. I don't hate him for running Flamethrower at all because Fire Blast tends to miss. Expecting him to switch out right there since I knew that he was scarfed from the damage, I just went for Wish. He does go into Zygarde, and I did not want to let Zygarde set up for free. I knew it could hit me with Stone Edge, but from this level of HP without any boost, he could not one-hit KO me. So I just went straight for Dazzling Gleam, doing a fantastic amount of damage and then getting back to full HP. Now since he does have a Coil Boost, his Stone Edges have perfect accuracy, and he can actually KO this Togekiss build with a +1 Stone Edge. So I'm going to go out into Fortress here, take Stone Edge fantastically. It turns out that he actually wasn't running Earthquake, which I was afraid of, because a +1 Earthquake could have KO'd me from there. But he probably expected me to have Rotom and Charizard, so I can understand why he didn't want Earthquake in this battle. Now right here, I just go right out into Rotom. I didn't want him to spin away any of my entry hazards, because I set up Stealth Rocks, and he surprises me with Fire Punch. Did not see that coming. You don't see that on Hitmonchan very often, but it works pretty well against Fortress. But since I decided to bring my speedy, yet bulky, Zapling Rotom, I'm able to take those Fire Punches pretty well, burn him, and now he's taking the residual damage of Life Orb and Burn. I get a little bit of HP back from Pain Split. I actually haven't seen the animation for Fire Blast in a while, so that actually looks pretty cool, the way that they animated that. Right here, I really thought that he was going to switch out. It just seemed really obvious to me, but he just stays in and continues Fire Punching. Didn't expect him to do that, but since my Rotom was at such low HP and I wanted to make sure it was strong enough to take on Zygarde, I knew he would probably spin away my rocks right here, but it was a free opportunity to get up a Wish, and then if he went out into, say, Zygarde or something, or Magmortar on the switch there, then I could go back into Rotom or have a free switch into something. So while he does go down here and gets rid of the rocks, I kind of get the switching priority because I get to bring in something basically for free. Depending on what he brings in, or I can just stand and take the hit. I ended up going with Air Slash and Dazzling Gleam on Togekiss, alongside Baton Pass and Wish. I didn't really see the merits of Heal Bell in this matchup, so I just got rid of that. Baton Pass is nice, though. Here, it allows me to go out into Rotom. Yes, I do get Toxic, but even better than that, I get that nice wish, getting my Rotom all the way back up to full health, basically, before the Toxic damage. I felt that he was going to switch out right here, even though he could have set up his own entry hazards. So I just went straight for Shadow Ball. I actually put Spell Tag on my Rotom for this matchup, hoping that I could maybe bluff a Scarf or something like that. But with the Spell Deck, the extra 20%, because I'm not too invested in Special Attack, did a pretty good amount of damage. And seeing that he actually doubled out right there into his Slurpuff, either I would assume that he expected a switch, or he might have thought that I was Scarfed and didn't want to get hit by another hit. So I'm able to go out into Charizard, and now I get a free Fire Blast off on something. I ended up going with Fire Blast, Roost, Dragon Dance, and Earthquake, because looking at his team, I can hit every single thing of his, every teammate that he had with one of those two attacks. Now, I do miss my initial Fire Blast, and while that sucks because Slurpuff lives to see another day, it now gives me an opportunity to take out Magmortar, because he goes for Wish, and the switch to Magmortar to me is painfully obvious. And worst case scenario, say he doesn't switch and he stays in with Slurpuff on the Earthquake, then I can just KO it on the next turn. But this is the best case scenario, as he goes out into Magnorar and I hit it with an Earthquake. So Mixed Charizard proving very effective. I stay in on Cloyster here. It was possible that he could have been Scarfed and had a Rock Blast, but if so, I wanted him locked in on Rock Blast. And more importantly, I did not want to let him get a free Shell Smash in my face. So I just stayed in there. He is carrying Focus Sash, which is why he really wanted to spin away those rocks. But now that he's down to 1 HP, I can finish him off at any point with my Crawdaunt. I just go out into my Fortress here to try to set up some entry hazards as I go down. He surprises me by going for Rock Blast and missing against my Charizard Y. Not really necessary. Icicle Spear would have been the better move while my Charizard was on the field. And then when I bring in Fortress, he misses the Rock Blast, and then he goes for Icicle Spear, probably figuring that it would take out Fortress. But I am max defense in order to be able to take on a Cloyster a little bit better. So I get up some entry hazards, so I'm definitely not too angry about that. Now, even if he switches out his Cloyster, it will be KO'd by entry hazards on the way back in. And with Stealth Rocks and Spikes up, his Zygarde is really going to be pressured as well. So I go into Crawdaunt here. I really needed to make sure I waited the sun out so that my water attacks wouldn't be weakened. I just went straight for Aqua Jet, not wanting to give the Cloyster a chance to hit me with anything weird. And Slurpuff comes in to take a critical hit Aqua Jet. The crit didn't really matter though, because I would get two Aqua Jets off, and two Aqua Jets most likely would have taken it out anyway, since an Aqua Jet and a half didn't take it out. So. Plus, I probably outsped it too if he's a defensive build, so I wasn't feeling too bad about that crit. As he comes in with Zygarde, I'm going to force him to go for Extreme Speed here, because if he wants to hit me, he has to use it, otherwise I will use Aqua Jet on him first. And Extreme Speed crits me right back for that crit that I got on Slurpuff, but does not finish me off, and I'm able to finish him off with another Aqua Jet, so we're on a little bit of a Crawdaunt tear at the end of the battle here. And that means he only has Bastiodon and his Cloyster left. And with the Sturdy broken by my entry hazards, I just get to go straight for a superpower here and rock this thing's face. I could have gone for the water move, but I was afraid of missing it and him, I don't know, using something weird. I don't know what I could have expected there, but I just didn't want to miss the crab hammer. So I went straight for superpower. That's another knockout right there. We still don't get to see what my Emboar does in any of these battles, guys. I keep bringing Emboar to battles, and here he just kind of pops out at the end of the battle to go, hey, we won. So that was a very solid 4-0 victory against the San Francisco Swampert. And thank you very much, Connor, for such an entertaining battle. That was pretty good there. I wasn't expecting several of the things that you brought. So something I'm going to be doing a little bit differently is, if you all will leave questions in the description for things you had questions about during the battle or things you want me to answer in kind of a post-conference battle, I'm going to try answering some questions, seeing just kind of after the battle how people feel about things. So we're going to give that a shot. It'll be a pretty short video, but it might be fun too. So I hope you guys enjoy the upload. Look forward to next week. We're taking on a shiny Marinok, so that'll be an interesting matchup for sure, because he has the wonderful Tyranitar Garchomp core in his team. So we'll check that out. And in the meantime, I hope you guys have a Merry Christmas and a wonderful day. All right, guys.